all. I welcome you to Adarsh Vidyalaya e-learning program. Today's lesson, 10th standard, goes to the night, the ghost garden. It is written by James Grover Gardner. It is a narrator's narrative stories. In the stories, the characters are Herman, Herman's family, grandfather, Mr. and Mrs. Woodworth, policeman and reporter. The theme of the story, imagination of all things, always leads to absolute humor. Humor means fun. Before going to the lesson, we should know about the author. Who is author? James Grover Gardner. His period was 1894 to 1961. He was American cartoonist, author, humorist, journalist, playwright, and celebrated wit. Wit means intelligence. He was the best known for the Cat, Bird, Sea cartoon and such stories. He was popular, one of the popular humorists in his period. Clear about this author? Shall we go the next? The summary of the, before we are in detail, we should know, just have a look of summary. It's happened now under 17, 1915 at 1:50 a.m. When the narrator
Dear children, take the page number 30. Imagination of all things always leads to absolute humor. Read the lesson and enjoy the narrator's experience with his grandfather who creates joyous and laughter with his imaginative stories. The ghost that got into our house on the night of November 17, 1915, raised such a hullabaloo of misunderstanding that I am sorry I didn't just let it keep on walking and go to bed. Its advent caused my mother to throw a shoe through a window of the house next to door and ended up with my grandfather shooting a patrolman. I am sorry, therefore, as I have said, that I ever paid any attention to the footsteps. Some words meaning odd, unusual, absolute, complete, choice, confusion, advent, arrival, patrolman, patrolling police officer, hello below. A lot of loud noise made by people who are excited. Explanation. Imagination of unusual things always leads to complete fun. This is narrative's imaginative story. We read and enjoy. His grandfather creates confusion and laughter with his imaginative story. November 17, 1915, a ghost entered narrator's house. It caused loud noise and excited in the house. Narrator's mother threw a shoe to neighbor's house to get help, but it came to end his grandfather shooting a policeman. Second passage. They began about a quarter past 1 o'clock in the morning, a rhythmic quick cadence working around the dining room table. My mother was asleep in one room upstairs, my brother Herman in another. Grandfather was in the attic, in the old walnut bed, which, as you will remember, once fell on my father. I had just stepped out of bathtub and was busily rubbing myself with a towel when I heard the steps. They were the steps of a man walking rapidly around the dining table downstairs. The light from the bathroom shone down the back steps, which dropped directly onto the dining room. I could see the faint shine of the plates on the plate rail. I couldn't see the table. The steps kept going round and round the table. At regular intervals, a board creaked. When it was trod upon, I suppose at first that it was my father or my brother Roy who had gone to Indianapolis, but were expected home at any time. I suspected next that it was burglar. It did not enter my mind until later that it was a ghost. Some words meaning: cadence, rhythm in sound. Attic, a room partially inside the roof of a building. Stepped out, came out. Creaked, made a sharp sound. Trod, walked softly. Indianapolis, a city in central Indiana. Burglar, a thief who breaks into the house. Explanation. It was about a quarter past 1 o'clock in the morning. Narrator heard the rhythmic sound of walking around the dining room table. His mother was asleep in one room in the upstairs, his brother Herman in another. Grandfather was in the attic. The narrator had come out of the bathtub and wrapping himself with a towel. When he heard the steps, they were the steps of a man walking quickly around the dining table downstairs. He could not see the table. The steps kept going round and round the table. At regular gaps, a plank of wood made a sharp cracking sound. When it was walking softly, the narrator thought at first it was his father or his brother Roy who had gone to Indianapolis. Next, he doubted that it was a thief who breaks into the house. It didn't enter his mind until later that it was a ghost. Third passage. After the walking had gone on for perhaps 3 minutes, I tiptoed to Herman's room. Pish, I hissed in the door, shaking him. Off, he said in the low, hopeless tone of despondent beagle. He always half suspected that something would get him in the night. I told him who I was. "There's something downstairs," I said. He got up and followed me to the head of the back staircase. The step had ceased. Herman looked at me in some alarm. I had only a bath towel around my waist. He wanted to go back to bed. I gripped his arm. "There is something down there," I said. Instantly, the step began again, circled the dining room table like a man running, and started up the stairs towards us, heavily, two at a time. The light still shone palely down the stairs. We saw nothing coming. We only heard the steps. Herman rushed to his room and slammed the door. I slammed shut the door at the stairs top and held my knee against it. After a long minute, I slowly opened it again. There was nothing there. There was a no sound. None of us ever heard the ghost again. Some words meaning: tiptoe, walk on one's toes; despondent, losing all hope or depressed; beagle, a hound; cheese, stop; go back, return to; instantly, immediately; slammed, shut with a loud noise; held, pressed tightly. Explanation. After the walking had gone for 3 minutes, narrator tiptoed to Herman's room, shaking him. Brother was making sound as a hopeless hound. Narrator told him who he was and there was nothing downstairs. Something downstairs. He got up and followed him to the head of the back staircase. The step had stopped. Herman looked at him in sudden fear. Narrator had only a bath towel around his hip. Herman wanted to go back. Narrator held tightly his arm and said, "There was something down there." Immediately, the steps began again and started up the stairs towards them. The light shone dimly down the stairs. They saw nothing coming. They heard only steps. Herman rushed to his room and shut the door with noise. Narrator also shut the door with noise and press his knee against it. Next, fourth passage. Now you come to the page number 31. The slamming of the doors had aroused mother. They peered out of her room. "What on earth are going you boys doing?" she demanded. Herman ventured out of his room. "Nothing," he said gruffly, but he was in color a light green. "What was all the running around downstairs?" said mother. So she had heard the steps too. "We just looked at her. Burglars," she shouted intuitively. I tried to quieten her by starting lightly downstairs. "Come on, Herman," I said. "I will stay with mother," he said. She is all excited. I stepped back on the landing. "Don't either of you go a step," said mother. "We will call the police." Since the phone was downstairs, I didn't see how we were going to call the police, nor did I want the police, but mother made one of her quick, incomparable decisions. She flung up a window of her bedroom, which faced the bedroom windows of the house of a neighbor, picked up a shoe and warmed it through a pane of glass across the narrow space that separated the two houses. Glance tinkled into the bedroom occupied by a retired engraver named Bodwell and his wife. Bodwell had been for some years in rather in bad way and was subject to mild attacks. Almost everybody we knew or lived near had some kind of attacks. Some words meaning aroused, awakened, peered, looked at, ventured, dared to do, gruffly, rough or deep voice, intuitively, without reasoning, flung, threw, open, picked up, took, warmed, struck violently, pan, sheet of glass, tinkle, fell down with tinkling sound, engraver, wood carver, in rather a bad way, not in a healthy. Explanation. The shutting of the door had awakened narrator's mother. Mother looked out of her room and asked what there was doing. Herman dared to come out of his room and said nothing with rough and deep voice. Mother asked what all that was running around downstairs and shouted that burglars without reasoning. Narrator tried to calm down her and he said to come on Herman. Herman said that he would stay with mother. Mother was excited and told them not to go escape and added that they would call the police, but telephone was in the downstairs. Suddenly, mother made quick incomparable decisions. She picked up a shoe, threw it neighbor's window. It struck violently a pan of glass and it made tinkling sound and fell down. It was Mr. Bodwell House window who was wood carver and he suffered short period of illness for some years. Now see the fifth passage. It was now about 2 o'clock of a moonless night. Clouds hung black and low. Bodwell was at the window in a minute, shouting, frothing a little, shaking his fist. "We will sell the house and go back to Poria," we could hear Mrs. Bodwell saying. It was some time before mother got through to Bodwell. "Burglars," she shouted. "Burglars in the house, Herman," and I hadn't dared to tell her that it was not burglars but ghosts, for she was even more afraid of ghosts than burglars. Bodwell at first thought that she meant there were burglars in his house, but finally he quieted down and called the police for us over an extension phone by his bed. After he had disappeared from the window, mother suddenly made as if to throw another shoe. Not because there was further need of it, but as she later explained, because the thrill of heaving a shoe through a window glass had enormously taken her fancy. I prevented her. Some words meaning frothing, throwing up foam, fist, tightly shut hand, got through, managed to convey the news. Heaving, throwing, enormously, a large, taken her fancy, appeared to her very much, prevented, stopped from doing. Explanation. It was about 2 o'clock of night. Bodwell shouting and shaking his fist. Mrs. Bodwell said that they would sell the house and went back to Poria. Narrator's mother managed to convey the news of burglars in their house. Bodwell at first thought that she meant that there were burglars in his house, but finally understood and called the police for them. After he had disappeared from the window, mother suddenly made as if to throw another shoe. No need of it. Narrator prevented her. She explained later that it was thrill of throwing a shoe through a window glass.
Do you understand the lesson? The remaining part we'll see in the next class. Thank you for watching.